Everybody said, the amen doesn't look uniform. I said, everybody said, God bless you all. Father, we thank you for tonight. Thank you for our workers. Thank you for our workers who are here and for our workers everywhere connected with us. We're asking, Lord, that tonight you impart our lives in Jesus' name. Make us faithful. Make us fruitful. And help us, Lord, that our strength will not fail in Jesus' name. Help us to center our heart, our affection, our love, our commitment, our loyalty unto you, unto heaven. And then to be focused on the great work you have put in our hands. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Tonight we're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 9. It says, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. Ye are God's building. As we read the scriptures, and it talks about the church, the body of Christ, the flock of Christ, the fold of Christ, and the sheep following after the shepherd. We have various metaphors used for the church, and also various metaphors used for the workers, for the builders, for the planters, for the sowers, for the soul winners, for the workers in the vineyard. And here in verse 9, he introduces us to both the church and the workers, the builders, and those who are involved in moving the church of the living God forward. Look at that again. It says, for we are laborers together with God. It's talking about we apostles and we pastors and we teachers and we evangelists and we prophets. And it says, for we workers and we leaders, we who are building. Because Jesus Christ says, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against that church is building. And now we're building with Christ. We're under shepherds, under the great shepherd. And we're under leaders, under the great leader. And then he has put us to be heads of little churches, local churches, under the head of the church. And it says we who are workers and leaders and builders, it says we are laborers together with God. It says ye, that is the church now, the body of Christ, the members of the church, the assembly of those who are called out. It says ye are God's husbandry, and it says ye are God's building. It's going to change his metaphor now, because he's looking at the church as a building. That's why it says here we are a building. And then he also says we are husbandry. That is, we're like a farm. And he's sowing the seed of the word of God. I'm coming back and I'm going to that same chapter. And I'm looking at verse 6. It says, I have planted. You see, it's using another metaphor now. Still talking about the church. And still talking about the ministry. It says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. I pray God will give the increase in our work in Jesus' name. And this ministry will prosper on our hands in Jesus' name. It says, then, so then, neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that giveth the increase. Now, he that planteth and he that watereth are one. It's saying that we're working in unity together. We're working together, and we're working in cooperation, not in competition. That's why it says here that he who plants, he who waters, he who brings in the souls, who does the follow-up, he who reaches out like a soul winner, and he who tends and helps and grows and develops the converts. It says we're one. It says we're together. It says we're united. It's actually we're having the same goal, and we're having the same drive, and we're having the same dream and final end in mind. It says every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. It says there's no need for competition. And there's no need to help, to hinder another person. And you don't have to come in front of another person and make him do less so you can do more. It says you have all the field before you, and you have all the chance before you, and you have all the possibilities before you. And it says, whatever we do, everyone will receive his own reward. And then it says, according to his own labor. It uses the imagery of agriculture that you find in planting and sowing and watering and then developing and gathering in the harvest. That's agriculture. Now it says there's architecture too. And in architecture, is looking at the building, and as he looks at the building, it says, we also build together with the Lord. Look at verse 10. According to the grace of God which is given to me. It says, as a wise master builder. Actually, if you look at the Greek original, it talks about a design that had been put there. A design that comes from God, and now he's a wise master builder. What's the wise master builder doing? He's looking at the design. He's looking at the pattern. He's looking at the ministry. He's looking at what God himself has designed, and he's walking according to that pattern. It's not saying, I'm so wise I can change the design. I'm so wise I can modify the design. I'm so wise I can, you know, tailor the design to my own taste. No, it is not your taste. It is not my taste. It is his own design, and it is what he wants accomplished. That's why he says, according to the grace that is given to me as a wise master builder, always looking at the pattern and building accordingly. He says, I have laid the foundation, and another builders thereon. He says, I've laid the foundation, and another builders thereon. He says, I cannot do everything. I laid the foundation here in evangelism, in crusades. I go to another city. I laid the foundation there in evangelism, in soul winning. I go to another locality. I'm laying foundation so that the people will come to the Lord, and they will know that Jesus only is our message. They will know that Jesus is our Savior. They know that Jesus is our sanctifier. They know that Jesus is our healer. They know that Jesus is the baptizer and the Holy Ghost. They know that Jesus is the coming King. That is the foundation. And he says, I've laid the foundation. Another is building thereupon. Another building thereupon. In the house fellowship already, we have those who convert. Somebody laid the foundation in their lives. And now we're building on the foundation. And then in the local church, somebody has laid the foundation and has brought them to the Lord, gathered them to the Lord. And they're gathered for you. And now you are building thereupon. Now he says, but let every man take it how he buildeth thereupon. Verse 11, for other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, that is Jesus Christ. As he comes then to these different illustrations and these different metaphors which are used for the church and also for the ministry to the church, it says, one, we are planters and sowers of the incorruptible seed. We are planters and we are sowers of the incorruptible seed. The seed is the word of God. It's the eternal word. It says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. It says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. That settled word that is settled in heaven, it says, that's the word we're planting. It says, the gospel is preached unto you which lives and abides forever. Number one, then, we're planters and we're sowers of the incorruptible seed. But number two, we're also the fishers of men. Do you remember when Jesus called his own disciples? He said, I'm going to make you do something. You have been fishing in the natural normal sea. I'm going to put you now into the sea of humanity, and I'm calling you so that as you follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. That's another imagery. That's another metaphor. That's another illustration. That's the practical name by which we're called, that we're there. We don't disturb the fish, and we don't scare the fish to run away. We're inviting. There is a bait, there is a hook, and we throw into the sea of humanity, and we're fishers of men. Number three, he calls us laborers in the harvest field. laborers in the harvest field. Do you remember when he said that the harvest is great and much, but the laborers are few? And then he calls us the servants of the kingdom. We're servants of the kingdom. It says the kingdom of God is like a man that sent out the servants, and then he says, go and bring in people. And those people did not respond. They came back to report, and he said, go back again and bring them from the lanes and from the streets and from the villages and from the towns. And he said, Master, we have done as thou hast said, but there's still room. He said, go back again and fill up my house. He says, compel them to come in. Which means then, as we look at the servants of the Lord and the servants of the kingdom, we're compelling them, we're convincing them, we're convicting them, we're driving them, we're drawing them. We're making sure that no matter who they are, no matter where they are, we're bringing them by good language, pleading with them, be ye reconciled unto God. In fact, that's the language of the ambassador we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, from verse 18 to verse 20. It says, we are ambassadors for Christ, ambassadors of the heavenly country, and we plead with you, be ye reconciled unto God. But you know, number 6, we're preachers and teachers of the heavens, of heaven's transforming truth. We're preaching the word of God, and the word of God we're preaching is transforming lives, is changing lives, is turning lives around, so that we can prepare them for the kingdom. And in the passage I've read to you now, number 7, we're builders of God's own temple. Builders of God's own sanctuary. Builders of God's own house. And as he calls us builders, he says, he's the wise master builder, and we are following after, and we're building with him. The Lord requires something from us. If we're going to do the work acceptably, the Lord requires something from us. If we're going to do the work rewardably, the Lord requires something from us. If we're going to do the work profitably, you cannot be faithful if you don't understand what the work is and how the work should be. And you cannot be fruitful if you don't know what the work is and how the work should be done. And you cannot be profitable, acceptable in the sight of the Lord if you do not know the work will be done. What does it require? Number 1, it requires faithfulness from us. Faithfulness from us is giving us the work, and you know, he's not, you don't see him, but he's, you know, actually watching how you do it. And our other leaders are not there with you, and you want to be faithful whether you see somebody or not. Number 2, truthfulness. Truthfulness, that you're true to the calling, that you're true to your own heart, that you're true to the people of God that you're leading. Truthfulness. And then there's honesty. Honesty. If we're going to do the work acceptably, rewardably, and profitably, there must be honesty. There must be transparency. Transparency. There's nothing you're hiding. There's nothing you're putting behind. There's nothing you're covering up. You're totally transparent in your mind, in your thoughts, in your life. You are transparent. And I pray that the grace for transparency the Lord will give to every one of us in Jesus' name. There should be trustworthiness. Trustworthiness. The thing is just left in your hands. Already you know the standard. You know the work of God. You know the work that ought to be done. And you are trustworthy in his service. Faithfulness will be eternally rewarded. But you know, on the other hand, unfaithfulness, dishonesty, and untruthfulness, hypocrisy, and falsehood, and compromise, and deceitfulness will be severely, eternally punished. Tonight, we're looking at the message, beneficial ministry with eternally rewardable sacrifice. Beneficial ministry. If a ministry is going to be beneficial, it's not something you do at a weekend, at your convenience, at the time when you are able, At a time, if you have an extra time, you've given the best to the world. You've given the best to your secular work. You've given the best to your family. You've given the very best you have to every other entity or section of your life. But now the extra, the useless one, your needed one, your needed time or needed period, I think I can now conveniently, without feeling any pain at all, I can give this to the Lord. No. It must be sacrificial. If it is going to be acceptable, if it is going to be profitable, if it is going to be rewardable, it will be sacrificial. That's why we're looking at beneficial ministry with eternally rewardable sacrifice. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the fundamental base eternally revealed. The fundamental base eternally revealed. Is that not something here? That the base of the building, the foundation of the building, is already revealed from heaven, eternally revealed. Look at it again. We read it before. Let's look at it again in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9. It says, "For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, and ye are God's building." Then it says, "According to the grace that is of God that is given unto me." Stop there for a moment. Without the grace of salvation, we cannot work for God. Without the grace of sanctification, the Adamic nature, not just a kind of it, not a doctored, and not suppressed, and not modified, and not shrinked, uprooted, and taken away. Once the nature of Adam is still there, once the original root of sin is still there, once self is still there, and it is rooted there, once there are many plants and many seeds that are not planted by the Heavenly Father, and they have not been uprooted, and they are still there, they'll be drawing you and pulling you here and there. But when grace comes to you, grace for salvation, and grace for sanctification, and grace for the service of the Lord. You remember when Paul the apostle was having challenge, and then he went to the Lord and said, "Lord, can you take this away from me?" And the Lord said, "Leave it there. My grace is sufficient for you." Grace for suffering, grace for suffering. There is suffering in the work of God, and there is a challenge in the word of God, in the work of God, and you have the grace to go through everything. Rain or sunshine, you have the grace. I said you have the grace. And God is going to help you to abide, even with the salvation, sanctification, suffering, and spirit baptism, empowered by the Spirit, energized by the Spirit, immersed in the Spirit. And he says, because of that grace that is given unto me, he says, "I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereupon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay. Other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ." It tells us here that the foundation is very important. Look at Psalm 11, and I'm reading from verse 3. Psalm 11, and we're looking at verse 3. If the foundation is no more there, and we're just laboring, and we're running, and we're climbing this mountain, and we're climbing this ladder, we're developing this, we're strategizing that, and we're putting a lot of things together, a lot of strength, a lot of money, a lot of ability, a lot of skill, a lot of planning, and yet the foundation, we've shifted away from the foundation. What else are we going to look for except calamity and sorrow at the end of the day? Look at Psalm 11 verse 3. It says, "If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? If the foundations be destroyed, the righteous people come in and they say, going to serve the Lord. What can they do? If the church removes the foundation of repentance, and the foundation of faith in Christ, and the foundation of restitution, and the foundation of sanctification, and the foundation of holiness without which no man shall see the Lord, and the foundation of one man, one wife until death do us part, the foundation of baptism, the foundation of growing in the Lord and the foundation of conditional security. If those foundations are removed and then we're just glossing over things, we cannot be definite anymore. And we cannot say spade is spade and this one is that one. And we're no more direct and we're no more firm on the foundation of the Word of God. He said, I've laid the foundation. I spoke about repentance. As I've laid the foundation, I spoke about restitution. Because he says, I exercise myself to have a conscience void of offense towards God and towards man. He says, I've laid the foundation. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. I've laid the foundation. Follow peace with all men, and the holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. He says, if that foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Think about your area of ministry. If the foundation is no more there, if the foundation is destroyed and crushed out and removed, and then we're just having ministry, it says, although you are righteous, but you can do nothing. We're coming to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 19. Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 19, it says, now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners. Ye are no more strangers and foreigners. You know, a stranger cannot be a worker. A stranger to the grace of God. A stranger to the Lord Jesus Christ. A stranger to the doctrines of the Bible. A stranger to the calling of the believer. If you're a stranger and a foreigner, you cannot be a worker. You cannot even be a member. But it says, now we're no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens and of with the saints and of the household of God. It says, and we are built upon the foundation of the apostles, the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. Jesus Christ himself, because he is the Savior, is the chief cornerstone. He is the sanctifier, is the chief cornerstone, is the baptizer in the Holy Ghost, is the chief cornerstone. Without him, there's no salvation. Without him, there's no redemption. He is the chief cornerstone, and it says, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord. Look at this, verse 22. In whom ye also are builded together. In whom ye also, as you get born again, builded together. As you are converted, builded together. As you give your heart, your life to the Lord, builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. Through the Spirit. Paul the Apostle has been talking on the foundation. Look at Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 1. So you will see what he's talking about. Hebrews chapter 6. Reading from verse 1. Therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrine of Christ, leaving the elements of the doctrine of Christ, leaving the rudimentary part of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on to perfection. Look at this. Not laying again the foundation of repentance. You see that? Repentance. That's part of the foundation. Not laying again. That is, I've laid it already. It's established already. It's brought in already. Let every man take it now. What he builds thereupon, there's a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. Of faith toward God. We turn away from sin and we trust him for our salvation. We turn away from sin and we trust the Lord to be our Redeemer and our Savior. Then he says of the doctrine of baptism. So there's a baptism there in the plural. There's a baptism in water. He says that's part of the foundation. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. And then there's a baptism in the Holy Ghost. He said that is part of the foundation. If the baptism in water is a foundation and the baptism of the Holy Ghost is foundation, obviously the one in between, sanctification, holiness, is also part of the foundation. If righteousness, if repentance is part of foundation, if righteousness is part of foundation, the one in between, the restitution, is part of the foundation. How come then that, you know, we don't, some people for a whole year, year will not mention repentance for a whole year, and there is no mention of restitution for a whole year. There is no mention of righteousness and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. That's part of the foundation. It says of the doctrine of baptisms and of laying on of hands. It says that too is part of the foundation. That is what Jesus said, that this son shall follow them that believe. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. It says healing the sick is part of the foundation. All that Paul the apostle did, and he said, I've laid the foundation. That means then in our ministry, if it's going to be faithful to the foundation and faithful to the base that is eternally revealed, all that we must preach. And then he says of the resurrection of the dead. He's talking now about eschatology, that you know the rapture will take place, the dead in Christ shall rise up, and then they go to be with the Lord, and then those who are dead shall be raised up, resurrection. And then he says of eternal judgment. I saw the dead, great and small, and he came and he stood before God, and the books were opened, and the book also was opened, and the people were judged according to their works, and death and hell were cast into the lake of fire, and whosoever was found not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. He says that is part of the foundation, for it's appointed unto men once to die, and after this the judgment. He says that is part of the foundation. He says after we lay the foundation, now we go on to perfection. You are going on to perfection. I say we are going on to perfection. And we're not going to allow the foundation to suffer in Jesus' name. And look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. Acts of the Apostles chapter 20. I'm reading from verses 20 and 21. Acts chapter 20. We're looking at verses 20 and 21. And how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you. Nothing that was profitable unto you. What does that mean? Repentance is profitable for the sinner, because otherwise he'll just labor and serve and come to church and go out of the church and give offering and give this and that. He'll never get to heaven without repentance. And because repentance is profitable unto you, I didn't keep that back from you. And also what Jesus said, you bring your gift to the altar and you remember that your brother, your sister, your husband, your wife, your neighbor has something ought against you, leave your gift there at the altar and go settle with your neighbor, with your brother, your sister, your husband, and your wife. He says that is profitable. I didn't keep that back from you. And then blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see the Lord. And you want to see the Lord eventually. If I keep that away from you and you are just worshiping and just serving, just going to church and just doing this and that, religious ceremonies, you'll not see the Lord. I didn't keep that away from you. And also you need power. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea, and then in Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the earth. He said, I know how that is profitable unto you. And I'm asking you, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? I didn't keep that away from you, because I know it's profitable, and I know the Lord is coming. And because the Lord is coming, get ready, that you are prepared, be ready when the Lord will come. I know if you are not ready, then all the worship will be in vain, all the service will be in vain. Therefore, I didn't keep that away from you. You think about your congregation, you think about the people you are ministering to, and you are asking yourself, are you keeping back things from them? The things, it's okay, that will be painful, that will be disturbing, and that will disturb his, you know, whatever, peace of mind. But without that, you cannot get to heaven. Without that, you cannot see the Lord, and you are keeping it away from them. Paul the apostle said, I've laid the foundation, and I laid that foundation everywhere I went, so that the people will come fully to the Lord, and the people be kept by the grace of God. Look at that verse 20 again, how I kept nothing back that was profitable unto you, but have showed you and taught you publicly and from house to house. It says, when I talk in public, I preach the same thing. And when I go in the private and I'm talking to people privately from house to house, I'm also leading them in the same way. I'm looking at these individuals. I'm discussing with him. He lacks this, he lacks that. And I'm asking him, have you been sanctified since you believed? I'm asking him, have you been filled with the Holy Ghost since you believed? I'm asking him, how ready are you? How are you setting your affection on things above? When I'm talking to them privately, it says, from house to house, I did what I did publicly. Look at verse 21, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that you will be as faithful as this great man of God in Jesus' name. Somebody is saying amen over there. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 24. Acts of the Apostles chapter 24. And I'm reading here from verse 16. Acts chapter 24. And we're reading from verse 16. See what the man of God is saying here. He said, herein do I exercise myself. Paul, why do you do that? Because I want to see the face of the Lord in peace. And then what do you recommend for me? Do the same thing. Because God is no respecter of persons. If God requires it from me, he requires it from you. If God requires it from him, he requires it from her. And he says, herein do I exercise myself. And he goes on to say, to have always, 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 to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. He says, I'm not a man pleaser, I'm not a man servant, I'm not just doing what I'm doing when people are there, when they are not there, because I'm responsible to God, because God will hold me responsible how I live and what I say and what I do and my interactions and my relationships. And I maintain this conscience void of offense toward God and toward man always. I pray that same grace the Lord will give to us in Jesus' name. And he tells us why he does that. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 9 verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9 verse 27. As it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, what happens? The judgment. After this, the judgment. And because of that judgment of God, that's why as we move around, as we preach the word of God, and as we call sinners to come to the Lord, we do it with urgency, we do it with pungency, we do it with penetrating message, we do it with seriousness, and we do it with all our hearts. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading from verse 10. It says, you remember what he said? He said, it's appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Look at verse 10. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. We must all appear. We apostles and we preachers and we pastors and we evangelists and we soul winners and we workers, we, every one of us, and the unbelievers too will appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he has done, whether it be good or bad. In the private, bad. In the public, good. When we're together with other people, we'll try to put on our best behavior, our best effort, our best service. But when we're by ourselves and nobody will see this, bad. And he says everything will come to judgment. He says in verse 11, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, that is, the Lord is going to judge severely, is going to judge fiercely, is going to judge in a fiery way. He says, knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest unto God. And I trust also are made manifest in your own consciences. I pray that the work we do will be approved of the Lord, will be blessed of the Lord, and it will be rewardable in the sight of the Lord in Jesus' name. The design of God's building is given from heaven, and the builders under the heavenly master builder, that is under Christ, have no right to alter, have no right to change, have no right to modify the foundation or any part of the revealed truth. God's word, the gospel of truth, the word of salvation, Christ's revelation with saving power, is eternally complete. It cannot be added to, it cannot be diminished. To try to adjust the foundation of divine truth is to claim to be wiser than God. Why are you adjusting the foundation? Why are you tampering with that thing? Well, because I want to improve on it. You want to improve on what God has given. And you are wiser than God, and it is to think that we have greater authority than Christ. It's Christ that said that we should teach everything, commanded to teach everything that he has commanded. And now somebody is trying to adjust that. He wants to have greater authority than Christ. He's higher than the Holy Spirit. Because Jesus Christ said that when he comes, the Holy Ghost, when he comes, he will reveal everything to you and guide you into all truth. Now the Holy Ghost has revealed everything, and the man is claiming to be higher than the Holy Ghost, is having, is more knowledgeable than the apostles of Christ. The apostles came and they said, as wise master builder, I've laid the foundation, and the man is coming and the woman is coming, and he wants to adjust this and make it better and make it more acceptable. Such pride is blasphemy, and such pride will be severely, eternally punished by God. The word of God is forever settled. We're looking at Psalm 119. It's not something you can add to. It's not something you can adjust. It's not something you can doctor. It's not something you can modify. Psalm 119. I'm reading from verse 89. In verse 89, look at what it says here. It says, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. We're looking at verse 8. Isaiah chapter 40, reading from verse 8. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. The word of our God shall stand forever. And that's the foundation of the word. You cannot add to it. The foundation of the word, you cannot modify. The foundation of the word, you cannot diminish. We're looking at Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24, verse 35. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall never pass away, shall not pass away. It says that word is eternal, that gospel is eternal. First Peter, I'm reading from chapter 1. First Peter chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 23. It says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. That's how we're born again. And if people are going to be born again in your ministry, in your outreaches, in your soul winning, in your evangelism, you must still bring that same word of God, because this word of God abideth forever. Look at verse 25. The word of the Lord endureth forever, and this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. The word abides forever, and this is the word, the gospel, which is preached unto you. I pray we'll be faithful to the word that he has given us in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number two now. The faithful builders eternally rewarded. The faithful builders eternally rewarded. We're coming back to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10. It says, according to the grace of God which is given unto me, he'll give you the same grace. I said he'll give you the same grace. As a wise master builder, if we're going to build, we cannot build in our own natural strength. We cannot build in our own natural intelligence. We cannot build with our own natural effort or natural power. We need his grace, we need his strength, we need his power, and we need his enablement so that we can build as he wants us to build. We need his eyesight, and we need his focus, we need his vision, we need his help to direct us and say, this is the way, walk ye therein, according to the grace of God which is given unto me. As a wise master builder, Paul the apostle is saying, it's not because I'm educated, it's not because I've studied this or studied that. He said, it's not because of what I got from seminary, theology, whatever religion of the Jews. He said, it's not according to natural ability, according to natural enlightenment. He says, all this is due to the grace of God. The same thing we can say about ourselves. You know, if you rely on your own education, you cannot do the work of God. If you rely on your own human strength, you cannot do the work of God. If you rely on your training, you know, I was trained in that place and trained in that place in secular work, and since I succeeded there, can't I succeed in the work of the Lord? According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man, no matter how high, let every man Apollos, let every man Cephas, let every man Titus, let every man Timothy, let every man, contemporary men and women of today, let's be very conscious that this is the work of God. It's not something you can tamper with. This is the work of God. It's not something you can arrogate to yourself and then do it the way you want. It says, let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For all the foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. It's telling us that faithfulness is required in builders. Faithfulness, that's what is lacking today in many places. I'm not talking about our church in particular. I'm talking about, you know, places outside there. Look at Psalm 12. I'm reading from verse 1. Psalm 12, reading from verse 1. It tells us in chapter 12 of the Psalms, reading from verse 1, help, Lord, for the godly man ceases, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. Once, you know, we turn our eyes off, and once the man is alone, once the woman is alone, once the youth is alone, once the student is alone, it's like, because nobody is watching over me now, I can think the way I want, I can go the way I want, I can do it the way I want, I can do it the way it feels good for me. It's telling us, no, it should not be like that. It's telling us that we should make sure that we are faithful. Faithful to the calling. Faithful to Christ. Faithful to the commission. And faithful to the things he has given us to do. It says, Lord, help. Help. We need the help of God. So that you will be faithful as I am faithful. I will be faithful as you are faithful. Help, Lord. He helps us with his grace. He helps us with his strength. He helps us with his power. He helps us with correction. He helps us by the Holy Ghost nudging us and saying, that's not right. That's not the way. This is the way to do it. He helps us by showing us the narrow gate, the straight gate, and the narrow way that leads to heaven. He helps us by reminding us how we started and by reminding us what we were at the beginning. Help God, for the godly man ceases. That he is there is a kind of depreciation of godliness. There's a kind of lowering of godliness. There's a kind of a belittling godliness. Godliness and the godly man ceases. And then he goes on to say, for the faithful fail from among the children of men. I pray God will keep us faithful. I said, God will keep us faithful. And then you're looking at areas of your life. In what area am I not faithful? In what area am I not standing to the truth that God has given him? What area am I trying to modify, trying to change, and trying to adulterate, and trying to alter? He wants us to be faithful. In fact, the people that will serve him are the people that give their hearts to faithfulness. Look at Psalm 101. In Psalm 101, I'm reading from verse 6. 6. Psalm 101, we're looking at verse 6. It says, mine eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land. I'm looking for preachers, my eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land. I'm looking for evangelists, my eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land. I'm looking for pastors, I'm going to look for the faithful in the land. I'm looking for women leaders, I'm going to look for those who are faithful in the land. I'm looking for the youths, and I'm looking for those who are faithful in the land. Not for those who are clever, not for those who can run faster than everybody else because they still have the youthful exuberance of them. It's not because, you know, they know this, they know this, they know that. It's the faithfulness everywhere. That's what God is looking for. It says in verse 6, mine eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land, that they may dwell with me. And it says, he that walketh in a perfect way, he shall serve me. He shall serve me. Look at verse 7. He that walketh deceit shall not dwell within my house. He that telleth lies shall not tarry in my sight. You know, there are people who are clever and they know how to, you know, put this and that together hypocritically and deceitfully. And yet, the Lord is saying, I'm not looking for those clever people. I'm looking for those who are faithful, who can do the work of God faithfully. We're reading from Matthew chapter 24, verse 45. Matthew chapter 24, and I'm reading from verse 45. In verse 45, it says, who then is a faithful and wise servant? Who then is a faithful and wise servant whom his Lord has made ruler over his household? And then it says, to give them meat. To give them meat. That is balanced diet of the word of God. The people who are sinners, to give them the kind of meat they need. Those who are believers, to give them the kind of the meat they need. And those who are workers, to give them the kind of meat they need. And those who are leaders, to give them the kind of meat they need. And you do that faithfully. And you do that conscientiously. And you do that always. And you do that continually. Look at that verse 45. Who then is a faithful and a wise servant? I pray you'll be faithful. You see, it's not just being wise, it's being faithful and wise. Faithful and wise. And as you put all those things together, that you are faithful, you're faithful to Christ, you're faithful to the word of God, you're faithful to the ministry, you're faithful to your calling, you're faithful to the commission, then you give meat to the people, the household of the Lord, in the due season. I pray God will make us faithful. You in particular, I pray God will make you faithful. We're looking at 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. 1 Timothy chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 12. In 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12, look at this. He's still talking about the faithfulness. In fact, Paul the apostle is talking about himself. He said, you know what? You know why he called me? You know why he put me in the ministry? Because of not education, because of not constitution, because of not predestination, because of not my strength, because of faithfulness. And it is when you are faithful, it does that. And I pray it'll do that in your life in Jesus' name. 1 Timothy chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 12. It says, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has enabled me, for that he counted me, what's the next word there? He counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Without that faithfulness, you lose the ministry. You lose your chance in the ministry. Faithfulness in the public and faithfulness in the public. That you are faithful to the Lord, and the Lord can read your heart, and the Lord can see your heart, the Lord can see your life, that you are faithful. And because of that, he delights in you. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and I'm reading from verse 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 2. Here it tells us, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. It's required in stewards that a woman be found faithful. It's required in stewards that a youth be found faithful. It's required in stewards that a worker be found faithful. He wants us to be faithful. Faithful to the Lord who has called us, faithful in the way he would have been faithful if he were doing the work. We're doing it, we're representing him, we're standing for him. And if he had been here, he'll preach repentance, be faithful. If he had been here, he'll preach restitution, be faithful. If he were here, he'll preach believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be faithful. If he were here, he will remind us there's no salvation in any other. But because there's no other name given among men whereby we can be saved except the name of Jesus, emphasize Christ as the Savior and Christ as the healer and Christ as the deliverer, Christ as the redeemer and Christ as the sanctifier, because it's required in every preacher, it's required in every pastor, it's required in every evangelist that a man, a woman be found faithful. God will find you faithful. I said, God will find you faithful. Faithful builders build, number one, according to the pattern from heaven. We build according to the pattern from heaven. There are many patterns here on earth, and there are many kind of adulterated patterns here on earth, but he wants us to build according to the pattern revealed from heaven. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 5. Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, look at this, see here, that thou make how many things? All things according to the pattern showed thee on the mount. It's giving us the pattern from heaven. Christ came from heaven and he came to reveal the standard. He came to reveal the gospel. He came to reveal the way of salvation from heaven. And he wants us to follow after that. Not only that, faithful builders build with purpose of heart. With purpose of heart. There must be the purpose in your heart. That's where I'm going. And then the purpose, whatever is there, there's a lion in the way. There are pitfalls in the way. There are difficulties in the way. There are dangers in the way. All the same, if I'm still in the ministry, if I'm going to know what God has called me to do, I have that purpose of heart that I'm following on, and you'll follow through in Jesus' name. We're looking at Daniel chapter 1, and I'm reading with from verse 8. Daniel chapter 1, we're reading from verse 8. It tells us in Daniel chapter 1, here reading from verse 8, telling us what kind of heart we ought to have and what kind of purpose of heart we ought to have. Chapter 1, verse 8. It says about Daniel, purpose in his heart, that he will not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he required of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. That he might not defile himself. You go on, you do the work with the purpose of heart. Number three, with pursuit of holiness. Pursuit of holiness. See yourself, you're pursuing that holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. And then you're influencing all the people, you're stirring up all the people, you're encouraging all the people, you're exhorting all the people, you're teaching all the people that they too will have that same pursuit of holiness. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, reading from verse 3. It says, this is the mind we ought to have, and this is the heart we ought to have as we're preaching the word of God. It says that no man in chapter 4, verse 3, it says, for this is the will of God, even your sanctification. It's the will of God that every one of us here should be sanctified, and thank God for sanctification. I say thank God for sanctification. Look at verse 7. It says, for God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. God has not called us unto uncleanness, but unto holiness. Number one, you're building according to the pattern from heaven. Number two, you're building with purpose of heart. Number three, you're building in pursuit of holiness. Number four, you're building with passion in humility. Passion in humility. You know, there's nothing to be proud of. There's nothing you have that has not been given to you. You cannot say, I'm successful, I'm better than so and so. No, it's the grace of God. I've run faster than so and so. No, it's the grace of God. I've established more churches than so and so. No, it's the grace of God. And we need to continue with the passion, passion in humility. It tells us in Acts of the Apostles chapter 20, Acts of the Apostles chapter 20 from verse 19, it says, serving the Lord with all humility of mind. That's Paul the Apostle, wise master builder. He was an apostle, he was a prophet, he was an evangelist, he was a pastor, he was a teacher, and he had been to the third heavens. The Lord really blessed that great apostle. But you know what he said? Serving the Lord with all humility of mind and many tears and temptations which befell me by the line in which of the Jews. And he says, how I kept back nothing that was profitable unto you, but I have showed you and I've taught you publicly and from house to house, testifying both to the Jews and also to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. And I pray that this same thing will happen in every life in Jesus' name. And we pursue with prayer for the harvest. Prayer for the harvest. This is not something I can say, I know how to do it. I know how to get it done. When I was in that place, this is where I did it. And when I came over here, this is the way I've been doing it. And anything, any challenge, I'm able to face anything. No, you need prayer. We need prayer. Prayer for the harvest. We're looking at Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. I'm reading from verse 37. Matthew chapter 9, verse 37. It says in verse 37, then says he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Then it says in verse 38, it says, pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send laborers into his harvest. That's the way we need to do it. And then with the posture of helpfulness, the posture of helpfulness, that is, you have the mind to help. You came into the ministry to help. You want to help on the harvest field. You want to help in soul winning. You want to help in the teaching of the word of God. You want to help in any area. And your contribution, your part to the work should be to help. You come with the posture of helpfulness. We're looking at 1 Chronicles chapter 12. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, I read from verse 17. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, reading from verse 17. And David went out to meet them, and they answered and said unto them, if ye become peacefully unto me to help me, my heart shall be knit unto you. He said, I have a work to do. If you have come to help, welcome. I have a challenge before me. If you have come to help, welcome. And I have an assignment the Lord has given me. If you have come to help, welcome. He's telling us that as we do this work, we must come with the posture and with the mindset of helpfulness. And then in the middle of that verse 17, it says, but if ye become to betray me to mine enemies, if ye become to hand me over to my enemies, seeing there is no wrong in mine hands, the God of our fathers look thereon and rebuke it. Look at verse 18. Then the Spirit came upon Amasai, who was a chief of the captives, and he said, thine are we, David, and on thy side, thou son of Jesse. Peace, peace be unto thee, and peace be to thy helpers. Somebody did not say amen there. And the God, that God helpeth thee. Then David received them and made them captives of the hand. And so you see, this is the attitude we ought to have. Number 7, we come in perseverance for heaven. Perseverance for heaven. You know, it's not going to be a short term relay, it's going to be a long term running. We're running the race. It might take a longer time than we thought, and therefore we persevere because we're desirous to get to heaven. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 11, Hebrews chapter 11, and I'm reading from verse 14. Hebrews chapter 11, reading from verse 14. It tells us, Hebrews 11, reading from verse 14, verse 14, for they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. I pray that this faithfulness for builders, the Lord will give every one of us in Jesus' name. And you remember all those points and you're saying, Lord, that's who I'm going to be and that's what I am going to be. Now, as we're developing other people, training other people, bringing other people in, this is exactly what is required. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 2, reading from verse 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're looking at it from verse 2. It says, and the things that thou hast learnt has heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit to faithful men, the same commit to faithful women, the same commit to faithful youths, the same commit to faithful believers, who shall be able to teach others also. The same you commit to faithful people, who shall be able to teach others also. Are the only men that are supposed to be faithful? Look at 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 11. 1 Timothy chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 11. It says, even so must their wives be grave, not slanderers, sober, faithful in how many things? Faithful, I said, in how many things? All things. The women leaders are supposed to be faithful in all things. The women workers are supposed to be faithful in all things. The sisters on the campus, in our youth and work, were supposed to be faithful in all things. And if the sisters are to be faithful, the women to be faithful, the mothers to be faithful in all things, it means then the men too. That's what we read in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 2. We must be faithful in all things. Just to refresh your memory, number one, we should be faithful in the home. Husband to the wife, faithful. Wife to the husband, faithful. Parents to children, faithful. Children to their parents, faithful. We must be faithful in the home. Because if we're not faithful in the home, then there's nothing to do outside. And when we're choosing workers, when we're choosing leaders, when we're committing things to faithful people, the very first thing to check up is, how faithful are they in their homes? We're looking at Titus chapter 1, I'm looking at verse 6. Titus chapter 1 verse 6. If any be blameless, husband of one wife, not one and a half wives, and wives of one husband, not one and a half husbands, not having an husband at home, and then relating to another man outside, as if, you know, so familiar and so whatever it is, as if it's another kind of a husband behind the screen, or relating to another woman outside, as if she's another wife behind the curtain. It says for the bishop, it says, if any be blameless, husband of one wife, having faithful children. Even the children are supposed to be faithful. The daughters and the sons are supposed to be faithful to what their parents are teaching them. If you cannot control your daughters, you cannot control your sons, then you are not faithful enough, because you are not faithful in the home to come to the work of God. And it says they are not accused of riot or unruly. Number two, they should be faithful helpers. And they know they have come to help. Like a wife is a help me to the husband. And then the women have a supportive ministry in the church. Not a ministry to hinder, not a ministry to slow us down, not a ministry to cut us off. It should be a ministry as helpers. We're looking at Romans chapter 16. In Romans chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 3 and reading from verse 4. Romans chapter 16, verse 3, it says, greet Priscilla and and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus. That is the work that Christ Jesus has committed to him. Here are people that say, Paul, we know the commission, we know the calling, and we're going to be helpers in Christ Jesus, who have laid, who for my life have laid down their own necks, unto whom now only, not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles. Praise the Lord. And then they should be faithful in the heart. We're faithful in the heart. It's not a superficial faithfulness. It's not something you make believe. It is something that from the depth of the heart, you are actually faithful unto the Lord. I'm reading from Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 8. Faithful in the heart. If you're going to be useful in the kingdom, profitable in the kingdom, faithful in the kingdom, rewardable in the kingdom, look at what he's saying. He's saying we must be faithful in the home, and we must be faithful as helpers. We must be faithful in the heart. In Nehemiah chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 8, just the first part of this verse 8, and foundest his heart faithful before thee. Let him find your heart faithful before the Lord, faithful in the heart. Faithful without hypocrisy. Faithful without hiding something or sweeping something under the carpet. It tells us in Hosea chapter 11. Hosea chapter 11 that you are faithful without hypocrisy. In Hosea chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 12. Hosea chapter 11. Reading here from verse 12, it says, Ephraim compasseth me about with lies, and the house of Israel with deceit. But look at Judah. Judah yet ruleth with God and is faithful with the saints. Other people have gone astray. Other people have changed their ways. Other people went in deceit and lying. But here we find this Judah, he was faithful without hypocrisy. Then, number five, you are faithful with all humility. You are faithful with all humility. You understand? The Lord has called you, and there's nothing to be proud about. Whatever you have done is of the grace of God. And you are faithful in all humility. We're looking at Matthew chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23. And we're reading from verse 12. Matthew 23, verse 12. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased. But he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. As we're working for the Lord, humility befits us. Humility is necessary. Lying low before the Lord is necessary. Giving all the glory to God is necessary. Being totally void of pride, pride of achievement, pride of talent, pride of ability, pride of position, pride of whatever. All that must be buried as we serve the Lord in all humility. He wants us to be faithful in all honesty. We're honest, we're loyal. In everything that we do, there must be honesty there. It's telling us in Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 17. Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 17. Here it tells us in Romans chapter 12, verse 17, recompense to no man evil for evil. While you are working for God, there may be people that cross your way, either intentionally or unintentionally. It says there should be no revenge. You shouldn't leave the work and leave the commission and leave your calling, and then you are running after this and that, and they are running and you are running, and you know, we leave the work and then we concentrate on non-essentials. It says a recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. As he calls us to faithfulness, that we ourselves ought to be faithful, and the people we appoint ought to be faithful, it says as we're bringing them into the work, we check up, are they faithful in their homes? Are they faithful as helpers? Are they faithful in the heart? Are they faithful without hypocrisy? Are they faithful with all humility? Are they faithful in all honesty? Are they faithful in all holiness? We're looking at Daniel chapter 6. Daniel chapter 6. And I'm reading from verse 4. Daniel chapter 6. And we're reading from verse 4. In Daniel chapter 6 verse 4, it talks about Daniel, and this is an example for us. These things are written for learning, upon whom the ends of the world are come. It says, then the presidents and the princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find none occasion nor fault, for as much as he was, what's the word here? Faithful, and neither was there any error or fault in him. I pray that the Lord himself, as we endeavor to raise up other leaders and reproduce other leaders and train other leaders, engage other leaders, assign other leaders, we'll find people who are faithful to build and to work and to labor and to evangelize with us in Jesus' name. Point number three now. Point number three. We're looking at the faulty buildings eternally ruined. The faulty buildings eternally ruined. We're coming to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 12. It tells us in verse 12, it says, now, if any man build upon this foundation silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire. And the fire shall test and try and examine and prove every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he has built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burnt, you know the possibility is there that all the service burnt, all the sacrifices burnt, all the running around, everything burnt, and there is no reward, and there is no value for it in heaven. If any man's work, any man's service, any man's ministry shall be burnt, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. What that means is that if he has not gone into open sin, into real sin, into what God calls sin, but that he is being careless, he's not done the work faithfully, his heart, his home, and his humility and everything he does has not been as faithful as the Lord required of his stewards, he says that work will be burnt, and then he'll be like a person that rushed out of a burning house. All the treasures in the house are burnt, all the boxes in the house are burnt, all the roof, everything, all the precious things in the house, they are burnt, but he escapes so as by fire. That's what the Lord is saying. You know, there are people that, they appear to be serving, and they're serving the Lord, but they're not faithful. Look at Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 14. Philippians chapter 1, verse 14. It says, and many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold. I'm much more bold to speak the word without fear. So far, so good. But look at verse 15. Some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife. And some also of goodwill. It says there are people who preach Christ. They preach that he's a savior. And they preach that he's sanctifier. And they preach that he's healer. And they preach that with him all things are possible. They preach Christ. But they do it of envy and strife. Look at verse 16. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely. This is sincerity in their service. And they preach with contention. It's like, you know, there must be a fight. It's like they must have contention in the work of the Lord they're doing. And they're striving with other workers. They're disturbing other workers. And they're trying to destroy the work of other workers. And they are also in the work, it says, the work is of envy and strife and contention and insincerity. That's what he's talking about. It means that such people, although they're doing what appears to be right, the attitude is not right, the mind is not right, the heart is not right, and it says they will not they will not be rewarded. We're looking at 2 Chronicles chapter 25. 2 Chronicles chapter 25. I'm reading from verse 2. 2 Chronicles chapter 25. Reading from verse 2. It says, and he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Don't stop there. Look at the latter part. Read the latter part for me. Your voice is weaker than mine. I thought mine should have been weaker because I appear older, but can you read that again? You are coming up now. He did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Anybody looking at what he has done will say, the man is doing great. The man is doing well. The woman is doing great. That woman is a great, great worker, a great leader, women leader. But you know what it says? But not with a perfect heart. How we need to watch our hearts. How we need to watch whatever we're doing and whatever we're saying so that our work will be rewarded by the Lord. Let me show you an example when it says, so you know, they do right what appears to be right, and yet it says, not with a perfect heart. I'm coming to Job chapter 42. Job chapter 42. And I'm reading here from verse 7. Job chapter 42 verse 7. And it was so that after the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord said unto, number one, Eliphaz the Temanite. Now it says, my wrath is kindled against thee, and against thy two friends, for ye have not spoken of me the thing that is right, as my servant Job. You see, there were three friends. They came to Job. And then they began to talk to Job. They talked about God. They talked about heaven. They talked about wickedness. They talked about punishment. They talked about a lot of things. And the doctrines they presented as they were talking to Job, if you look at it on the surface, everything looks all right. And yet God is saying here, I didn't find you talking right and talking well. And they were condemned in the sight of the Lord. Let me show you number one of them is Eliphaz. We're looking at Job chapter 4. Job chapter 4, we're reading from verse 12. In Job chapter 4, and when you look at what he said, when you look at the doctrine he gave, you see there's nothing wrong in this. True, there's nothing wrong with that. But the heart, but the intention, but the motive, that's what the Lord was talking about here. He says, Eliphaz chapter 4, look at verse 1. Then Eliphaz the Temanite answered and said, what did he say? We're coming to verse 12. It says, now a sin was secretly brought to me, and my ear received a little thereof in thoughts from the visions of the night, when deep sleep falleth upon men. Fear came upon me, and trembling, which made all my bones to shake. Then the spirit passed before my face, and the air of my flesh stood up. It stood still, but I could not discern the form thereof. An image was before mine eyes. There was a silence, and I heard a voice saying, shall mortal man be more just than God? Shall a man be more pure than his maker? There's nothing he said that was wrong. Shall a man be purer than God? Shall a mortal man be more just than the Almighty God and his maker? No. And he was right. But his attitude was wrong. The application he made of his message was wrong. He was applying it to Job. And now God said, I've not found you righteous before me. I've not found you saying the right thing concerning me. He continues speaking in chapter 5. Look at his condition, his conclusion in chapter 5, verse 27. Lo, this we have searched it. And so it is. Hear it and know thou it for thy good. He spoke authoritatively. He spoke convincingly. And then he called Job to verdict and to conclusion. And he says, know this for thy good. At the end of the ministry, at the end of the time, at the end when God was going to evaluate everything, he said, you have not spoken right concerning me. Although you spoke authoritatively and you spoke convincingly, but you didn't do the right before me. Look at the person. The next person is Bildad. Bildad, we're looking at Job chapter 8. Job chapter 8, I come to verse 1. Then answered Bildad the Shuhite and said, what did he say? We're looking at that from verse 5. In verse 5, he says, if thou wouldest seek unto God betimes and make thy supplication to the Almighty, if thou wert pure and upright, surely now he would awake for thee and make thy habit the habitation of thy righteousness prosperous. Though thy beginning was small, yet thy latter end shall greatly increase. It's not said anything wrong. Everything he said here was right. And at the end of his ministry, at the end of his counseling, at the end of his advice to Job, the Lord came and he said, all you three, you have not spoken the right thing concerning me. Look at what he said in verse 20. In verse 20, he says, behold, God will not cast away a perfect man, neither will he help the evildoers. He says, till he fill thy mouth with laughing and thy lips with rejoicing. And then he goes on to say, they that hate thee shall be closed with shame, and the dwelling place of the wicked shall come to naught. That's right, that's right. He said what was right, but his heart was not right. His attitude was not right. He filled a faulty builder, and the building now is eternally ruined. His work, there is no reward. Look at the third person, Zophar. Zophar in chapter 11, Job chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 1 in Job chapter 11. This is a third person here that God said, you didn't speak right concerning me. You didn't do well. Your ministry is not acceptable. Look at verse 1. Then answered Zophar the Naamathite and said, what did he say? Look at verse 7. In verse 7, it says, canst thou by searching find out God? Canst thou find out the Almighty unto perfection? He's saying God is so big and God is good, so great, and it's like an ocean so deep and so wide, you cannot go through everything and fathom everything. He said in verse 9, it is as high as heaven. What canst thou do? Deeper than hell, what canst thou know? The measure thereof is longer than the earth, and he says broader than the sea. That's right, that's right. God is infinite, God is eternal, and is so deep and is so high and so wide and so broad, you cannot know the end of the glory of the Lord. That's right. But the Lord said, you have not spoken right concerning me. How we need to find out then, we might be doctrinally right, but our motive, was that wrong? Their ministry did not stand the final test of fire. And the question is, will your own stand? Are you faulty at heart? Are you unfaithful in ministry? Are you self-centered in action? Like these three friends of Job, you're walking and walking and walking, but your heart is not right. Your attitude is not right. Your motive is not right. And it says on the final day, everything will be consumed by fire. That means your work and every detail of what you have done, where will you stand then when God comes to judge and when God comes to evaluate? Are you thinking of the final day, or you just walking and walking? We must think of the final day and come back to this first Corinthians chapter 3. First Corinthians chapter 3, reading here from verse 9. In First Corinthians chapter 3, verse 9, for we are laborers together with God. I pray we'll walk with all our heart, with all our mind, with sincerity, with faithfulness, and with honesty. and our work will be rewardable in Jesus' name. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry, and ye are God's building. Then he goes on to say what he has done, and he's encouraging us to do the same. According to the grace of God which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. And we can apply it to ourselves. You know, somebody else has laid the foundation, and you are called upon now as a worker. You are called upon as a singer. You are called upon as fellowship leader. You are called upon in any area of work, and you are building thereon. How are you building? With a good motive, with a good heart, with a good intention, and so that your work will be profitable, rewardable, acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Another buildeth thereon, but let every man take heed how he buildeth thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, something precious, silver, something precious, and precious stone, something enduring, or wood, temporary, or hay, worthless, or stubble, that will burn to a fire. Every man's work, every man's ministry, every man's service, every man's activity will be tested by fire, shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try, shall test, shall prove every man's work, what sort it is. If any man's work abide, which he has built thereupon, is establishing the converse, is strengthening the workers, is the converse, and is making the people to believe more in holiness, more in righteousness, is making the people to love God, to respect God, and to respect the house of God, and is building something precious as is following up, he shall receive a reward. And if any man's work shall be burnt, the one that has no sincerity, no good heart, as is doing the work of God, is just there because, you know, it's always there, and it's even disturbing the other people that are trying to build and trying to do something of great importance, consequence to God. If any man's work shall be burnt, he shall suffer loss. But he himself, if he remains saved, he himself, maintains a good relationship with the Lord, he himself, if his life is still based on that salvation and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord, he shall be saved, but so as by fire. But in all eternity, he'll be empty-handed. In all eternity, he'll be regretting. Had I known, I could have done better. I could have served the Lord better. I could have done the work of God the way it should be done. But now it's too late because they cannot come back and get the work done again. While there is chance to make correction, while there is chance to lean upon the Lord and the grace of the Lord, so that he will forgive our past and they will forge on like the dawn of a new beginning, we can have a new beginning. And we can have a new dawn, and then the work of God will prosper in our hands. There will be no competition. We'll be complementing each other's work and helping every soul to get farther and farther into the kingdom. And our works will be rewarded on that final day in Jesus' name. We'll rise up as we talk to the Lord in prayer. We've learnt a lot. We need to take to the Lord in prayer. And we need to pray with all sincerity, with all honesty, with all faithfulness. We need to pray for the grace of God, that the grace of God will be abundant upon our lives. And this work will do it the way he wants it done. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord in prayer.